Thank you. Welcome to my presentation about hexagonal architectures with Kotlin, of course, because we are on the Kotlin Dev Day. First, a bit about myself. I'm Jan Verhoeckx. I'm a software developer at Topicus Healthcare, and I'm currently working on Spreker.nl. A bit about Topicus. Topicus is a software development company around the size of 1,100 employees, and with offices throughout the Netherlands in multiple cities, as you can see. We built multiple platforms. So maybe you know us in education, for example, student tracking systems, Parnassus or Sontoday, but also in healthcare. So during the Corona pandemic, we built Coronet to register the vaccine, the vaccinations. And of course, Spreker.nl, the platform I'm building on, in Kotlin, of course. And it's a platform, an app, where you can get in contact with your GP. But enough about Topicus and me, let's talk about hexagonal architectures. First, I want to talk about the traditional layer pattern, because I think everyone knows the layer pattern. Then we will take a look at what the hexagonal architecture, what it is, how it looks like, what the principles are of a hexagonal architecture. The pros and the drawbacks of an hexagonal architecture, because there are no silver bullets in software architecture. And finally, I will show you how you can build your own hexagonal architecture and how Kotlin will help you to soften the pains of the drawbacks this architectural pattern will introduce. So let's begin. First, who likes lasagna?
Yeah.
Yes, pretty good, right? So lasagna looks a bit like the layer pattern. You have layers of pasta sheets, and in between you have tomato sauce, meat, and cheese. But also in lasagna, the sauce and the cheese is leaking through the layers. In the classical layer pattern, we see also the layers you define. So for example, the presentation layer, business layer, and persistence layer. The abstraction layers you build are also leaky. And this is a problem because then your domain code gets cluttered. And in my opinion, your domain code is the most important code of your application. It's where you define the behavior of your application. So the business rules, the requirements are all there. So let's take a look at an example. What we see a lot is, for example, the persistence layer is leaking up to the domain layer. So maybe you are using an object relational mapper. For example, here I've used, for an example, Spring Data and GDBC. And this can be a domain class, but now it's cluttered with persistence layer information. So for example, you can see the table name, you can see what property is the ID in the database, and you can see the ID columns of the collections, where the joins should be. And also this information is needed for the object relational mapper to work. So maybe now it's not a big deal because it's still manageable, but when you are adding your domain logic in this class, and your object relational mapper isn't performing anymore, so the queries have to be optimized, it will it gets cluttered with more information. You have to say which collections are eager, or how they have to be fetched. And also your domain is, when you're using Hibernate, proxied, so you can't use it like without pitfalls in your domain code. So let's take a look how we can fix this with an hexagonal architecture. So the basics are you divide your application in two parts, and we call this the inside of the hexagon and the outside. And the inside is where your domain logic lives, so the behavior of your system, and the outside is where the infrastructure code lives. And the infrastructure code we divide in two separate parts, the driving adapters and the driven adapters. So for example, a driving adapter is calling your domain code so it can be executed. For example, a REST controller for a web application. And a driven adapter, a classic example, is the database, so your data can get stored. So do you remember the layered architecture from my previous sheet? And I fixed the, I applied here a dependency inversion. So I instead the business layer was depending on the persistence layer. Now the persistence layer is depending on the business layer. And basically this is the essence of an hexagonal architecture. Because now the business layer is not depending on anything anymore, and it can be, it is not dependent on what the databases looks like or your driving adapters looks like, so like your REST controller. So the main code is central. And this can be achieved with dependency injection. And I think a lot of applications are already using dependency injection. So maybe you already have something like an hexagonal architecture. So a bit about the origin of the hexagonal architecture. It's a term coined, of a pattern coined by Alistair Cockburn. It's he's also known as the co-author of the Agile Manifesto, and it's also known as the ports and adapters pattern. So you can see you define your domain logic and you build you define your ports where the adapters can interact with your domain. And the original intent of this pattern was to allow an application to equally be driven by users, programs, automated tests, or batch script, and to be developed and tested in isolation from its eventual runtime devices and databases. So you can say it's the domain code that has to be central and independent. So the advantages of this pattern are the independent domain logic. So you can focus on your domain logic, you can build it independently. You can easily modify your application. So for example, you can swap out your database adapter and replace it with another one. And you can also do this when you're running tests. So the testability is also improved. So for example, in your test suite, you don't want to store your data in a real database, but maybe an in-memory database. Or maybe you don't want to test your domain logic through a REST API, but through a command line API, for example. This also allows you to delay technical decisions. So you can develop your domain and your business logic without the need for to pick your, for example, again, your database right away. But you can put off this decision to when you actually need to store data. And for example, you can swap out your Spring framework with Ktor without affecting your domain code. But as I just said, there are no silver bullets in software architecture, so there are also some drawbacks. And I think the main is there is a learning curve. So there are a lot of developers who know the layer pattern, but the hexagonal architecture or the ports and adapter pattern is not so that familiar. So they have to learn how this pattern works before they can interact with the code. But when other developers know this pattern, it should be more easy to learn a code base. So another drawback can be the framework annotations can be used in your domain code. So it can be more difficult or more cumbersome to use your framework features. And I will show in an example. Also, there will be a lot more plumbing and mapping code because you have to glue your adapters to your domain because your domain can be dependent on your adapters. And I will show you how this works and how Kotlin can help us to soften this pain. So let's take a look how hexagonal architecture is built. And we start from within, so from the inside, the domain code. Then we will add a driving adapter so we can execute our code, a driven adapter so the result can be stored. We will add configuration to wire everything together. And last, we'll tell you about the package structure, how you can organize your code so this pattern will be expressed in your code base, and how you can enforce this pattern. So for this example, I build a fictional domain, a medication dispenser. It's like you have a patient, and medication can be dispensed to the patient, but there are business rules. The patient can't get, there has to be checked the medication dispensed isn't interfering with previously dispensed medication. So let's take a look at this example. This is a domain object. And as you can see, if you can remember the domain object I showed in a previous slide with the database annotations, you can see here there are no object relational mapper annotations. So this is pure Kotlin code and pure domain logic. So no framework, no libraries, pure domain logic. But this code can be executed by itself. So you have now a domain object, and then we need a domain service. So this data can be retrieved from, for example, the database. Put an operation, execute an operation on it, and the result, and store the result. And also, this domain service is also pure Kotlin, no framework or library logic, and also this is again pure domain logic. So we only are focusing on the behavior of our application. You can see here I defined I'm using patient repository and also medication registry, and these are ports. So these are interfaces which will supply a runtime implementation which this domain service can use. So for example, this is what the port will look like. It's just a simple interface, and it defines the methods which can be called, and you can think of it as a USB port. So your computer has a USB port, and you can plug in any USB device. As long as the interface is correct, it will work. So the advantage of the testing, you can see a unit test here. And also here we aren't relying on the adapters or the driven adapters of the driving adapters. We are just mocking the interfaces, and now we can define the expected behavior in the tests and execute the code, and only test the domain logic and not side effects like the how the database is behaving. So let's add a driving adapter. As you see, we build a port, and the port is in this case the domain service, and the port will be implemented by an REST controller. So this is infrastructure code. We are using Spring Boot, so we have a REST controller annotation, and this is fine because we are now in the infrastructure part of our application. The medication dispenser is injected in this controller. So the medication controller is dependent on the medication dispenser, and that's not a problem. But somewhere we have to wire this together, and we will come to that in the configuration slide. So obviously we want to store our result. We execute an operation on our domain, and the result needs to be stored. And therefore we add a driven adapter, so for example a database. And this is where it becomes more more difficult to use in hexagonal architecture, because now we have two domains. We have a persistence domain and the domain code. And we have to map these models together. So when I retrieve with find all the collection of patients, these patient objects aren't stored in the database because the patient object doesn't contain the information for the object relational mapper. So I wrote an extension function on the iterable patient entity, and the patient entity is the class with the object relational mapper annotations to map the list to the domain objects. This way, you can use a Kotlin extension function on a list to easily and with concise code map the collection of your domain of your persistence objects to your domain objects. Also, you can use the data classes in your database adapters, so they the data stays immutable in this layer. And also use the copy functions to easy copy your code or duplicate the objects. So let's go to the configuration code, how we can wire everything together, because now we have adapter and ports, and the domain code needs to know where to call the adapters, and the driving adapters needs to know where the domain code is. And therefore, we use, again, in the Spring application, the beam configuration. This is also infrastructure code. And here we can use the single expression functions from Kotlin to concisely define the dependencies and inject them in our domain code. And we can also see we are using a stub medication registry, because maybe I don't have this code yet. And I delayed this technical decision to a later point where we actually implement this. And till then, we can use a stub and easily swap out this adapter for the real medication registry later on. So now we have a complete hexagon. And you can add a lot of more adapters. So the hexagon is not like you can only have four ports, but it's more like the figure to the shape you can draw on a whiteboard to easily express this type of architecture. That's why the ports and adapters is also a common name. You can have infinite adapters and ports. So the package structure, how do you express this architecture in your code base? You divide your code in two main packages. So your domain, the inside of the hexagon, and the infrastructure, the outside, the adapters. And the rule you have to follow is the domain code, the code in the domain package can be dependent on anything. And you can enforce this with, for example, ArchUnit. And ArchUnit is a unit test framework where you can enforce architectural rules. So you can easily say code in this package cannot call code in another package, cannot depend on each other. Another way to do this is with Gradle modules. So you can contain code in one module which can call code in another module. So let's recap. In my opinion, the most important code you can have is your domain logic. It's where the behavior of your application is. It's what you can test. It's what your customers will ask from you, the requirements, the business rules. So you have to make sure you can focus on this code and not mix it with, for example, your persistence logic. Now, with this pattern, you can also write tests for your domain logic only and not just all the infrastructure code with it. Delay the technical decisions to the right moment when you know have enough information how you will implement these external factors. And of course, easily change your infrastructure. So now we are using Spring. Maybe later we want to use Kator. Maybe even later we want to go to a more Lambda setting in the cloud. You can extract your domain code and put it in another environment. And also enforce this architecture with, for example, ArchUnit or Gradle modules, because a mistake is easily made. And of course, use the Kotlin features to limit the amount of the boilerplate code, so your code will be concise and more readable. So this was my presentation.